been a dream of mine since I've arrived at Duke 5 years ago to create spaces for intellectual discourse that combines and intersects with practical discourse, dancing, performances, conversation, to try to open up spaces in these United States of ours, such as they are these days before our election, spaces that actually engage in urgent matters that help us understand how art makes a difference. And I think that this symposium is really one of the first that we've done in collaboration with our friends at Duke Performances and also the National Museum that really helps us create this space where SLIPPAGE, Duke Performances, National Museum are working together to try to imagine differently what can be possible in terms of rethinking dance.
Locus is a key work not only in the sense that it inaugurated Trisha's interest in investigating dance movement, but she used it as, in this case, her entire career as a form of lecture demonstration in which she shows you what that famous book by Mabel Dodge called The Thinking Body. She's showing you the intensity of thought that is married to the generation of movement in her work. And she also described to me this piece as what she considered the closest thing she had to a bar, because Trisha never codified any of her movement. And this was, she said, the best thing she knew for warming up both the body and the mind.
Like a good autobiographer, Brown took creative liberties in how she told her own story. To make the 3-minute solo inside, Brown claims not to have listened to the walls, a practice in spatial and historical sensitivity that I suggested a few moments ago, but rather she explains that she read the walls of her loft as a score, and afterward translated this score into an abstract, idiosyncratic series of movements that was at once evacuated of and laden with her domestic reality.
Interesting here to me about Cumming's work with Meredith Monk as an early postmodern performer is how she described her role in the dances that she performed. When I asked her what role she played in those early pieces from the house, she smiled and she said, "I played the black girl." Of course, that was not a role that anyone would necessarily aspire toward in postmodern work. And her confession, if you will, underscored the ways that race circulated in the memory of that emergence of creative craft. Cumming's brief resume recounted here also demonstrates her turn back toward people and larger narratives of meaning as being crucial to making art. This investment of communal and familial possibility within postmodern dance certainly grew from her work in the house, but also from her work in black dance and black modern dance sensibilities. Black dance gathered its theoretical moorings around the same time that postmodern dance emerged. Black dance was decidedly interested in sharing energy and ideas and movement with audiences in direct, unequivocal fashion.
The objective changes from each day. So in the first day, I'm in my left circle, that I call it, and I'm standing with my feet parallel position towards the wall, just nose tip a few inches from the wall, toes tips a few inches from the wall. And I'm drawing, in the left-hand circle, I'm drawing, initiating movement with my right hand and instantly mirroring that the pathway and directionality of the lines into my left hand, so it looks like pure unison drawing, but there's actually a game of chase happening that I'm trying to sustain for the entire 4 hours against, you know, the tiring, the decline of the body, and I don't know, I'd say actually not decline of the mind, because that space becomes even more clear, but just trying to maintain that integrity and to fill the space within the span of my arms with this sort of hyper-spontaneous movement. And you can kind of see that idea of that micro-collapse and that micro-reflex where it looks like a lot of musicality, but it's just trying to generate and inspire movement from this idea of the ground through the body into the wall and to balance that friction between both pencil tips. And what kind of arose is this a lot of gesture in the hands that I didn't suspect in passing the graphite stick between my fingers, and I don't know, this piece kind of found itself, it also kind of accidentally found itself referencing body anatomy, which I'd say a good amount of my work ends up doing, so it's interesting that through these rules of play and these applications, so much anatomy becomes apparent.
Many of these things were touched on so beautifully by Susan Rosenberg's scholarship, who I've had the pleasure of working alongside for a number of years. And I wanted to start with some of what she spoke about, this idea of Trisha being fascinated by the animate potential of the body in terms of how the joints function through extending, bending, and rotating. And part of what I've considered is how can we take this idea of joints or joins and look at what joins may be in an archive. So what are the joins in Trisha's creative practice, and what is an archive fastened by joints or jointedness? The other consideration I've made is this idea that in Trisha's work, there's this beautiful irreverence that shows up visually, textually, kinetically, in the kinds of documentation that emerge. Again, she wasn't working from any kind of codified dance language. So again, the documentation that emerges captures the idiosyncratic nature of her way of working. And especially, there's this very erudite and vibratory and sensual movement of the thought through the body into gesture, and then the ways gesture becomes spatially mapped, spatialized, and framed. So Trisha's artwork, as I'm sure you're all familiar with, really looks at the framing of gesture, the framing of body, the framing of choreography. And for me, there's this beautiful analogy then to film as a mode of documentation.
I first experienced the company when I was in school at Mount Holyoke, and Carolyn was in the company dancing at the time, and they were workshopping foray. And I had a chance to see the company working on this piece and development about as close as I'm sitting right now to Barbara Duffy, and then saw them in performance, and thought, and just fell in love with the work, but thought, oh, I could never dance that. And moved to New York, and within a few days of moving to New York, Kelly McDonald, who was then in the company, approached me and asked if I was interested in doing a scholarship workshop, and I said, sure. So I went and was one of three dancers who was being taught material. And so when I was watching Shelley, and Corey was asking, where are you right now? And Shelley was dancing Glacial Decoy, I was in Bill Young's loft in Soho with Shelley, learning Glacial Decoy. And I can just say that from the moment I lived the work in my own body, I felt like I had found home.
I also had never been introduced to Trisha in any academic setting, and I was in my second year of college at SUNY Purchase, and I was taking my composition class, and it was wonderful because there was a continuing education student in the class, and she approached me saying that she really wanted to take me to see Trisha Brown at Brooklyn Academy of Music in 1981. So it was, I just do remember seeing Son of Gone Fishing, Opal Loop, and Glacial Decoy, but I was absolutely like mesmerized, enchanted by the movement and the dancers on the stage. I couldn't even see what a genius choreographer Trisha was yet. I was 19 years old, and I just wanted that and only that. And so I was